Well, if you have any good ideas, you should just shoot them my way, or...
I can send you a couple.
All right, Taylor?
Okay.
So, is this like when class is supposed to start, or is this adding 5 minutes? What time does your other class get out before this? 8:31?
8:30.
8:31, yeah.
We're
going to start late.
Yeah.
I'm trying to diagnose why.
Okay. Welcome to seminary, everybody. It feels so quiet in here. Isn't this nice? We don't have a Bailey's Corner today, but we have a bunch of fun stuff. So, Trevor did what must be done. Thank you for doing that. Brittany gets to do the musical share and personal share today. Eliza's giving her opening prayers, and Anderson's doing the closing. And any announcements that we have other than what already has been planned?
Roseburg won last night.
Yay.
The Unified team did pretty well.
That's awesome.
Cool.
Yeah. Charles and I had a great time at Mutual.
Oh my gosh.
All y'all
yes.
Guys. Brittany came for a bit. I don't know. You guys, I don't know if we're going to do a video of how things turn out, but we're doing
we
like...
We'll show everybody.
Yeah, we'll show everybody how it all goes.
Jeff Bentzel was so much fun last
time. You'll have to find out. Wait and see.
Cool.
But yeah, go to Mutual. It's worth it. It's a lot of fun. It's a good time.
Yes.
It is.
Yeah. I think that's everything.
Good. Okay.
So this is a piano guys video. It's one of my favorite songs, and it's also instrumental. So I don't know, just being able to find the peace in music is one of my favorite things, because not everything could go so easily and so peacefully. But if you bring good music into your life, you could have that joy.
Started this thing a few years ago, we thought, how are we going to sustain this? It was when our founders stepped in, they saved us. They actually created this opportunity for us to use full time. We built this entire Piano Guys adventure upon their shoulders. Thank you.
we're thankful for everything that was given us so we can participate in the lesson and get something out of it, and that we can apply it to our lives and help others around us. We bless that we can be a light and guide people into you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
So for the doctrine and master that I chose today, it was in the ordinance and covenant section, and it's DNC 8210, and it says, "I, the Lord, am bound when ye do what I say, but when ye do not what I say, ye have no promise." That's pretty scary.
Pretty what?
It's kind of scary.
Kind of scary?
A little bit.
How come?
What is
like
when you don't do what I say, you have no promise.
Yeah. So it's kind of up to us. Mm-hmm. A little bit of responsibility there on our part.
Yeah.
That actually, I'm glad you shared that, because that helps answer one of the questions today. One of the basket questions. So you're right on, Glenn.
So that song, it's called A Sky Full of Stars by Coldplay, and I really like that it's a cover of piano and cello. Cello is a very beautiful string instrument. It's actually my favorite. And it just, stars are one of the many creations that Heavenly Father made for us, and I love looking at the stars. I've been able to find some constellations recently, and the stars are starting to get brighter, so you'll be able to start seeing them more. But the stars are just there to show His love for us, I believe, because He wouldn't have something so pretty if He didn't really love us. And I say those things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Cool. Good thought. You know, I was in a class at BYU once. I don't know if it was a biology class or something, but I learned that human beings will only encounter, like, do you have any idea the percentage of species that have ever existed on this earth that have, you know, gone extinct? Like, the percentage that human beings will actually encounter? Right? Have you ever come across it or learned something about that? Like, how much life, different kinds of life there are? It's like 0.03%. If you can think of all of the organisms and all of the kinds of plants and animals that and creatures and little organisms there are, that's like less than 1% human beings will actually ever know.
Human beings as a collective.
Collectively, yeah.
Not individual.
Right, like we as a population. Ever since the world, like there's so much that God made that we won't ever even know about, which means somehow God created all of this for us, and God really loves His creations. Like, He likes to make stuff also for His own enjoyment and pleasure. So if we get some kind of pleasure or enjoyment out of looking at the stars, and it helps us just feel the sense of wonder and awe, you know, humility, God also gets a great amount of pleasure out of the things that God makes.
I also think that we can believe that we are probably going to end up going to the stars. We're gonna branch out.
Yeah, the future is exciting, isn't it? Okay. Has anybody had any thoughts about the conversation yesterday? We sort of dipped into kind of a big topic. Thanks a lot, Ben. And kind of left it. Has anybody had any additional thoughts or questions or pondering about what we talked about yesterday about literalism versus figurative? The figurative value of scripture? Scripture stories, anything? I mean, if there isn't, that's fine. I'm not expecting, but I want to have a chance to discuss if anybody's got something on their mind or pressing about that. Anderson?
Nah, right, sir.
Okay. So, that being the case, we do have some basket questions I'm working through. I think we're going to answer all but maybe one, and then we'll do that other one starting tomorrow, probably. So open up your scriptures. We are going to read in from all of the scriptures, I think, today. So have them available, please. It's great to have something out to take some notes, because here's why. It's like, I don't think that I'm going to say something great necessarily, but I could. It's possible that I might get inspired and say something that's helpful to you. But more importantly, the Holy Ghost, like you have qualified yourself by sitting here where you are now to receive personal revelation. You're in the right place at the right time. And that is so much of the battle in allowing God to speak to us, is just being in the right place at the right time. We're not perfect. We're all struggling. We're doing our best with what we have. But look, you're sitting here and your eyes are open and you're listening and you're paying attention. And that qualifies you for some revelation that you need in your life, because God knows what you need. So at any moment, you might be struck by a thought, or the Holy Ghost might take you out to lunch, and you might not even know what's happening in this classroom, but you're on a little journey into thought or understanding something. It's really good to just jot those things down, because you forget them so easily. Because they come quietly, and then they can leave, and if you value them, then you write them down. So I love it when you just have something available to take a note on if something strikes you as useful. Okay. Okay, well, these are the two. These are three that we did yesterday that we started on. So this is the first one. Does God love everyone equally, terrorists or prophets? All the same, does God love everybody equally? And I think we determined that some people found some scriptures that were helpful. And the answer is yes, God's love is universal. And it extends to everyone unconditionally. Equal opportunity and equal access to God's love. That's how it's universal and unconditional, is in terms of access and opportunity. But very practically, we all understand, not all will receive or experience God's love the same. While he may be loving them, they may not be feeling or receiving that love in the same way. Certainly we don't. Blessings are conditional, based on our use of agency. God wants everyone, but will force no one. So don't misinterpret God's love for God's blessings. Very different things. And it's because of the atonement of Jesus Christ that we all have equal opportunity and equal access. Because life can seem really unfair. But the atonement is a great equalizer. Let's read two verses here. John 15:13 and 1 Nephi 11:17. First one there to John 15:13. Please read it. I put a few new candies in there, but they'll be gone pretty soon. I need to go shopping again. Who's got John? Great scripture about love. Bryson, read it to us, man.
Greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends.
Who are the friends of Jesus? Everyone. Did Christ lay down his life for you? Yes. Did he lay down his life for the person sitting next to you? Yes. But did he lay down his life for the worst of all human beings? He did that too. Everybody's covered. 1 Nephi 11:17. Charles.
And I said unto him, I know that he loveth the church, nevertheless I do not know the meaning of all things.
Okay, that's a lovely one. Because you're not going to be able to explain everything. You're not going to understand everything. Not everything's going to make sense. But you can still understand that God loves you. And that is the most important thing. I've said it multiple times. Feeling God's love for you in a way that you understand it and know you're feeling it is a total game changer in life. If you haven't experienced feeling God's love, that is something that you want. It's something you need, because it anchors you solidly in some truth that changes everything about how we interface and interact with the gospel and with other human beings. We need to feel God's love. It's not easy always to do that. Trust me, I know. I've actually studied Mother Teresa a lot, because she mentioned that she felt most of her life she was in darkness. The amazing woman she was, she felt alone and in darkness most of the time. And I had a guy tell me once, when you don't see the hand of God in your life, trust in his character. Somebody said yesterday, it's hard to trust God when things don't go the way you want them to, when they're out of your control. And that's true. When we don't see God's blessings the way we think we want to, sometimes it's hard to believe that God's there or that he loves us. But trust in his character. And once you felt that he loves you, you never forget that ever. You never move back. Like, you never move back from having felt God's love for you as an individual. And so you can trust in his character even when things are tough. Even when you're having a hard time and you feel alone, if you have felt his love, then you know that he's watching over you and he's letting you experience what you're experiencing because of his love for you. Okay, second question. Will you not be wanted in the church if you don't serve a mission? I'm not going to answer this right now. I did write down a few scriptures we can read, but I want to hear what you think. Will you not be wanted in this church if you don't serve a mission? What is it about the social pressure of serving a mission? What if you serve and what if you don't? You know people who have and who haven't. What do you feel about the people who've served and who haven't served? Or who've come home early from a mission? Like, what are your thoughts on this? It's a really good question. It brings into culture and social and spiritual aspects. So let's go with Charles first.
So this doesn't directly answer the question.
Indirect will be fine.
But so I talked to my dad a little bit about this, and we were talking about how sometimes, like, people get back from the mission and they go inactive.
Not sometimes, lots of times.
Lots of times.
Pretty high percentage.
And so we were talking about how a lot of the times I'd assume that, will you not be wanted in the church if you don't serve a mission? I assume that it's a young man asking this question, because
is it the same for women and men
in
the church?
No,
the pressure.
Not the same, because
they've
asked that the young men, they're encouraged and asked that the young men go, right?
It's a responsibility.
Yeah. Exactly. It's part of that priesthood path, right?
Right.
But it's important to understand that a mission is not the end goal. And a mission is not a covenant. Right?
Good.
So me and my dad were talking about how people will get back from their mission, and like, their mission is, that's what they've been gunning for, that's what they've been pressured into, but that's what they felt
sometimes,
pressure for their whole life, right? And so when this goal is met and it's done, it's like, what next, right?
Yeah.
And so
I've achieved it.
Yeah, exactly.
Now
it's like, now what
am I supposed
right?
to be?
And so we talked how really the goal is eternal marriage in the temple, right? And making that covenant. And so,
oh, that's interesting.
And keeping it.
And,
well, yeah, because okay, you get married in the temple. Now you're married.
I know.
Same concept though, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So the mission is just helping you get there, right? The mission isn't the end goal.
Okay. It's
right?
A step along the way to
exactly.
becoming.
It's part of the path. It's not the end of the path.
Good.
Right? And
okay.
So
if you don't go on a mission, then...
So, and that's like sticky stuff, right? And I would say I can't give the answer for that.
Well, if you don't go on a mission, can you still get to the ultimate end goal?
Yes.
Okay. We agree that, yes, you can.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I was just thinking, because you just said that, what if some people think that if it's not the end goal, then what's the point of even going on one if you can get to the end anyway?
Good question.
That's fair.
Yeah, it's totally fair. If I can get the prize without doing that amazingly difficult, hard thing, like, why would I? Okay.
Well, think about it this way. Like,
can you still have eternal life if you've sinned? Yeah.
Though your sins be crimson, they can be made white as snow. So yes, there is a way to overcome.
Then I can just sin all I want, right? No.
Yeah. But then you can have to repent.
You're gonna have to
all
repent.
You must.
That's abusing and mocking the Lord, though, if you're sinning. It's
exactly.
Like all
so it's
there.
Like...
We all sin knowing we're sinning. It's like, if you can't sin in ignorance, then it's not a sin. Right? So we all know when we sin. Just like, so yeah, that's not... So there were hands, Eliza and Iola, and then Taylor.
I really liked what Amina said. I think people often think that way, you know, like, I don't need to go on a mission. And you don't need to go on a mission. But the purpose of a mission is, one, to grow yourself, and two, to help others.
Okay.
And that's the reason we were sent here not alone. We were sent here to help others, strengthen others, have them strengthen us. We're not sent here just for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And so the purpose, so you go on a mission, yes, you can reach the ultimate goal without going on a mission. But it's also great to go on a mission to help others reach the ultimate goal, because you feel the blessings of it. You want others to feel the blessings of it.
Okay, good. And it's hard to get to the point where you're going to serve a mission for other people. I mean, because you might not love other people all that much. You might not be all that interested in people in some city somewhere in Des Moines, Iowa, you don't know or care about. It's like, so it's hard to conjure up a motivation to go serve, to bless other people. That's usually secondary. Just like you said, it's not the primary reason. Usually people will go because they know it's going to be good for them, and because they don't want to not go, and because they feel like they owe something to God. There's something about that relationship there. You want me to go? Well, you've done so much for me, so I'm going to go because you asked me to go. But okay, good. Iola, and then Taylor, and then Ben.
In addition to what Eliza said, going on a mission is just one way of bringing others to the end goal.
Can you still be a missionary without being on a mission? Certainly.
Lots of people do it.
And get blessed by it in a major way, yeah. Anybody who's had a chance to do some real missionary work knows the joy that it brings. But, Taylor.
Going on a mission is... you make sure to pray about it and you feel like you've gotten an answer, like, going on a mission is fantastic, it does a lot for you. It's not the first or the best path for every single person. The best path is whatever the Holy Spirit or whatever the Holy Ghost tells you to go on. So
let me challenge you a little bit on that. What if I don't like going to church? I don't like the social part of it. It's like I want God in my life, but I don't really like that. Can I opt to find God or do that in a totally different way? I can go into the mountains instead to find God because that works better for me. Is that okay? I mean, do you agree with that? If it's sauce for the goose, is it sauce for the gander? Like, does it work in both ways? Does God have, has the responsibility been rescinded that every worthy and able young male serve a full-time mission? Has that responsibility been withdrawn? It hasn't. So there is something there that it says this is where you ought to be if you are able and worthy to go. This is where you ought to be. So it's not the same as saying, well, if you want to or not, and whatever path you choose is the good one for you, whatever you're comfortable with, that's what you should do. It's not quite in that camp. I don't know, is that what you were saying? Or do you want to rephrase?
It's what the, like, you have to have a pretty clear prompting. Like, I know that there's a couple of...
To not go?
Yeah, to not go.
So it's just like, the light is green.
Yeah.
Okay, the door is open. You don't need revelation to go... serve a mission. That door is already open to you. You don't need God to command you to go do something you already know is a good thing. Right? At least for young men, it's a different optional thing for young women. But still, Like, if you have the chance to go, in a way, why wouldn't you go? Because it's a good thing, right? So assume that the light is green and only change direction if the light is yellow or red. Okay? Assume the light is already green and that's you go through the intersection. Okay. Unless some other. Is that kind of where what you're getting at?
Yeah. Okay. I know that, like, my sister had some few of her friends that I knew pretty well, and for one or two of them, they felt a pretty clear prompting to not go on a mission, that they had another
sisters.
Another purpose.
Right.
Well, they're men.
Okay.
Men and women. And then other ones felt like they didn't know what they should do, and they went on a mission, or other ones did go on a mission. Like, okay, so there were one or two that did feel like that was not the truth, like that was not the path for them.
Okay. That's interesting, and I'm not saying that can't happen. I totally respect and honor that, even for young men. That would be a case-by-case basis, and if I was that young man, I would be taking that under heavy counsel with those I trust to help me understand Revelation. I really would. But good. Thank you for sharing that. Anderson.
I kind of understand where you're asking this is coming from. And I've asked myself the same question. And that's led me to do a lot of kind of prayer and study over it. And I've started to realize that the thing about the church is that I personally really, really dislike the culture that has been kind of adopted by the people of the church. But then if we think about, then I started to think, who are the people that I've met in my life in the church that are so, that I, when I think of someone who's Christ-like, I think of them. I think, do they have that culture? And I think, no, they don't. And then I realize the aim of the church, we need to simply, I feel like a lot of times we too often confuse the people of the church with the doctrine and the gospel of the church and the true teachings, because we're here to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man. We're here to help people grow, not only spiritually, but in every other way possible, just as people, and to help people make better choices and become better and make the world a better place. And just think about that feeling you get when you serve someone and they're so grateful, and you just give some selfless, that feeling you get. A mission is the opportunity to do that 24/7 every day without having to worry about anything else other than following the Holy Ghost and serving people.
Mm-hmm.
And so don't think of it as, hey, you want to join the church? Hey, you want to join the church? Hey, you want to join the church? Because a huge part of missions isn't that. It's, I mean, they aren't even doing door-to-door here anymore.
A lot of service.
And now it's mostly serving people, and then people realize they've got that light about them. What is it?
Yeah.
And then they find that.
Good.
And
so I'm with you. So what you're taking the side of, why wouldn't you go? Because it's good for you and it's doing good for somebody else. Even though there may be stigma associated with not going on a mission, like you're talking about good reasons to go.
Yeah.
My thought on this was, I think maybe the person's asking a little bit of the wrong question. So, will you be not wanted in the church if you don't serve a mission? Well, socially, and let's be honest. It's like, if somebody doesn't go on a mission, you say, why didn't they go on a mission? Maybe it's because they're not worthy. Maybe it's because they don't have a strong enough belief or a testimony. We assume there's some deficit of some kind. Otherwise, why wouldn't you go on a mission, right? I mean, there's that sort of social assumption. I mean, we can be honest about that. Why didn't they go? Something must not, ... right? And so you sort of fill in the lines. And it's not like people want to be judgmental and they think, you know, I know some wonderful men in the church who serve my family well in bishoprics and who have not gone on missions. Right, okay. So yes, you can get to the place, but there's still something to deal with in that space when you could and maybe should be on a mission and you're not. Let's acknowledge that.
You're going to have to answer to that.
You're going to have to deal with that. So the question I would say that's a better question is, will you want you in the church? if you don't serve a mission. Not, will the church want you in the church? Will you want you in the church if you don't serve a mission? That's the better question. That's the reason why people will or won't stay active when they could or should be on a mission and they're not. The struggle is there because they wonder if they belong in the church. It's not the church saying we don't want you. So how you feel, this is what my, how you think and feel about yourself has more of an impact than how others think and feel about you.
Because we need to build our foundation not on the people in the church. We need to build our foundation on Jesus Christ. I mean, it's the church
one-on-one
Jesus Christ.
Exactly. And we've been through this a few times in this class. What does it mean to be the true church? And we've separated that all out. And, you know, it's helpful to do that. And that's kind of what you're talking about. You weren't in here for those lessons, but you understand the concept. So think about that more. How will I feel about me if I don't go on a mission? Will I feel comfortable, secure, in my place in the church? Yes, you can. Absolutely, you can. But it's an obstacle to deal with a little bit. So I've known young men that I taught who went on missions and came home early. And for worthiness issues, had to spend a year at home. Didn't quite get everything cleared up in their interviews. Okay. So hard for that young man to come back and be at church 2 months later. And everybody's like, oh, what's going on? You know, well-meaning but ignorant people getting in your business. And it's like, ugh. It was all he could do to keep coming to church. But this young guy, he stuck it out. He came to work for me a bit. We had a really good relationship, and he had a great bishop. And he went back and served his mission, and he is just doing amazingly well. And married and has kids in the temple. It's like, it all turns out. But sometimes that path is hard. And it's really hard when there's a social piece that you feel some stigma. Chase.
Are there, like, alternates to go on a mission, right?
There are. There are different, now it used to just be, there's the 2 year full-time mission or a year and a half, that's the mission. The church is doing a really good job now of opening up other alternative avenues to serving a mission based on the capacity of the individual. I think that's maybe kind of what Taylor was also getting at. There are opportunities for you to serve a mission that may not be the traditional old school full-time mission, depending on your physical, emotional, mental capacity and your desire. The important thing is that you want to serve the Lord. That the important thing is that you want to do what God wants you to do, even if it's scary or hard. That is really the becoming part. Being on that path may not necessarily mean you have to serve a full-time mission. But being on the path means I want to do what God wants me to do, whatever that is. And that may take an alternative path based on the capacity. So thanks for bringing that up, Chase. You're absolutely right. Any other thoughts on this? Okay. These verses are... Well, I don't remember what's in them. We're going to read them, but it's okay. We might not need to. Tomorrow, how do you keep anger from turning into hate? Good discussion today. Loved what you had to say. I'm going to leave this with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Anderson.
Heavenly Father, we are so, so thankful for our country, for our safety, and for the people around us that we have that really want to help us. Please bless us. We may all know, both in our minds and in our hearts, who is willing to help us and who is there for us, and that we will not hesitate to ask for help when we need it. Please strengthen us. That we may, and remind us that we may turn to Thee and build our foundation on Thee, that we can grow stronger, and that we will choose to act rather than rather than stagnate, that we will choose to grow rather than stay where we are. Please bless those who are not feeling well, who are struggling, and please give those of us who have resources to help others, please give us promptings that we may help those who are in need, and remind us, please help us that we may be reminded to keep the Holy Ghost with us always, that we may seek to invite the Holy Ghost and to listen to it. Please bless us with safety this day, and nevertheless, thy will be done. We pray for these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Next question. Thanks for being here, Charlie and Michael. See you guys tomorrow. Feel free to pipe in with your comments if you have them. You just have to start talking because I can't see hands raised or anything like that.
Okay.
Okay. See ya.